They were really misunderstood. And I think Jim in particular took that real personally, because he tried very hard to be explicit. And he really didn't, like most performers or well-known people, really didn't have a chance to defend himself. He was presumed guilty from the very beginning, even though he really never did anything wrong.
All I remember is like being on the road, and we'd all have our little motel rooms or whatever, and there'd always be knocks on the door going, "Where's Jim? Where's Jim?"
When you're a rock star, male variety, one of the things that you get with it, one of the perks that come with stardom is a lot of women. There was one single female in his life who provided a thread through his life, and that was Pamela Curson, a young, attractive woman that he met while in Venice before the band was put together, and who remained with him right up till the end. He referred to her as his cosmic mate. He wrote songs about her. And however stormy their relationship may have been, he kept going back.
It was another one of those love-hate relationships. So Jim would get back at her by, you know, immediately going out with someone else or not taking her on tour or whatever.
Pam, I think, was mainly good for Jim in that she was able to cool him out when nobody else could. And like, he always seemed to be on his best behavior when he was on good terms with Pam.
You love me, don't you, baby? I knew you would. Well, climb all over me, baby. Touch me. Come on, play with me.
Felt like we, as performers, were just, I mean, we knocked them dead 90% of the time, 10% due to technical problems, you know, and I was real proud of that. We just really killed them, and I saw that percentage getting worse. I wanted more of that feeling on stage, you know. I mean, I like the success, I like the money, sure, but there was something real special when we played, and I could see that slipping away, you know. And I could see him, the man, disintegrating.
He had to live on the edge 24 hours a day, man. He was always out there. And sure, man, that caused a lot of problems. He was really hard to, it was hard to live with, man. It was hard to go on the road with Jim Morrison. It was hard to get on airplanes, man, and go into airports and try to, you know, get from Cleveland to New York and to Chicago to Boston, man. That stuff was really hard to do. Miami, needless to say.
I'm just amazed that he was always on the edge, and he always pushed himself. It wasn't that he was afraid of life. He was testing life all the time. Because, you know, with the advent of psychedelics and stuff, you realize that, we are on the edge anyway, so, and I think that prompted him to explore those regions all the time. At a concert, for instance, you know, after the show, you know, John and Ray and I would be pretty well spent, you know, and we'd just go off and do our thing, but Jim would still be partying, you know, he'd be out. Hanging out with some of the people and getting crazy and right through the next day. And we knew we had to do another show the next day, right? So we would all say, well, we better go to bed and get some rest here. But Jim never thought of doing that. And that's why I think that we never really did any long tours that were mostly pretty short trips, because Jim finally would get tired.
Jim was obviously a very wild guy, man. He lived his life on the edge all the time. The rest of us lived our lives on the edge when we played our music. When it came time to play music, that's John and Robbie and I got off playing music, man. I mean, the experience of playing together was so intense and so strong that there was very little need to go out into everyday reality and go crazy. Jim, as I said before, man, had a burning fire inside of him.
My first reaction was sort of to be mad at him, you know. But it wasn't because of the commerciality of it all. I mean, we were doing fine. How much money does one want to make? It doesn't matter after a certain point. But I saw this guy whom I felt I was pretty close to in the early days, starting to self-destruct.
The quality always was, is he going to be Jekyll or is he going to be Hyde? Is he going to be the calm, erudite scholar or is he going to be a crazed kamikaze pilot drunk, right? When he was a drunk, it was an odds-on against getting a vocal. You might look into it. When he was being the hard-working poet, you'd get a great vocal. Jim always liked to test people, test their person, just as he tested his personal frontiers. He liked to find out what the personal frontiers of the people around him were. He'd push every button in sight, you know, every motivational button, to find out where your wall was.
You never knew from one day to the next what Jim was going to do. And Jim on stage could be very outrageous, man. And Jim got busted in New Haven, arrested right on stage, man. They just dragged him off the stage and said, "You've gone too far, young man. You can't be saying those things you're saying." He was telling a story about the cops macing him backstage, man. He was backstage making out with a chick, man, and got maced because they didn't know who he was. So he goes on stage and he tells this story. He starts to tell the story about this little blue man in his little blue cap pulled out this can, man, and sprayed it at me. And who is he to do that? Who does he think he is? He's our servant. Cops are public servants, man. And Jim's going on and on and on, baiting the police. And at one point they said, "That's it. Boom. You're arrested, man. Inciting to riot, breach of peace, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera." And they hauled him away and put him in jail. That was like really the beginning of our being concerned that Jim could very possibly go off the edge at any time, and the whole thing we'd worked for could be nullified.
Come on, turn the lights on. Turn them way down. Hey, Mr. Lightman. You gotta turn those lights way down, man. Hey, I'm not kidding. You gotta turn the lights down.
Sky was the limit before Miami for the Doors. They had not given in to their audience's expectations, yet they had continued to delight their audience. I think Miami was an unfortunate but necessary step in the Doors' career.
I think what happened was Jim